Lynn, Susan, Paul, members of the family, colleagues, and friends, we are here today at a sacred moment. It is incumbent upon us to pay our respects to one who gave to each of us and to this university so much. But we are also here at a moment of joy to celebrate a long life that was exceptionally well lived. Harry was quintessentially Yale. He not only had multiple degrees from this university, but served this university for almost the entirety of his career. He came to Yale College as an undergraduate and never left, except for a brief tour of duty during the Second World War and for a five-year period following his graduation from this school as a minister for Disciples of Christ churches. Even in retirement, Harry remained a part of this university, living in what many of us affectionately call Yale North, the Whitney Center. And as a resident of Yale North, he served as an unofficial advisor to many, including to this dean. During his career, Harry served in such a wide range of administrative roles that the record sounds, to be candid, fictional. Beyond his home here at the Divinity School, he was the head of two Yale colleges, Trumbull for 10 years, and I know the current head is here, the acting head of Saybrook for 1 year, the university chaplain and pastor of the Church of Christ in Yale, as it was then known, for 6 years, and the acting director of ISM, the Institute of Sacred Music, not once, not twice, but three times. He kept coming back. Throughout all of those varied administrative appointments at Yale, he was a member of the faculty of this school and eventually was appointed the Horace Bushnell Professor of Christian Nurture. And true to his character, he also had administrative roles here. He was the associate director of field work for 4 years, an associate dean for more than 20 years, and had the role of the dean for a semester in an interim period. I don't think that anyone at this university will ever replicate the career that Harry Baker Adams had at Yale University. It was a different time, and he was an extraordinary individual. The extraordinariness of Harry, I think, lay in his combination of competence and grace, toughness and sensitivity, loyalty and personal humility, candor and care. It was all supported by a deep faith in God and in the goodness of his fellow human being. This last week, one alum wrote me, "As you prepare for his memorial service, please know that there are countless YDS graduates," that's Yale Divinity School graduates, "like me, whose dedication to our call was affirmed by this great teacher and friend. When I think of YDS, Harry Baker Adams is the image in my mind." No higher tribute could be made. Would you now bow with me in a word of prayer to the God whom Harry served throughout his life? Gracious God, source of all life, we bow to recognize your transcendent goodness reflected in the beauty of our world, your love that warms our hearts like the shafts from the sun's rays that caress our skin on this cool day. We raise our voices in gratitude for the pulse of life, for the joy of human friendship and community. We thank you for Harry Baker Adams, who brings us together today as a community, for his integrity, his generosity of heart, and his commitment to others. We ask you to enfold Lynn, Susan, and Paul in your love, to comfort them as they now say goodbye to their father, even as they have already said goodbye to their beloved mother. As we worship you and honor Harry, we ask you to strengthen our resolve to serve you and our fellow human beings, as Harry did so faithfully in his life, through the one who showed us the divine in human form, we pray. Amen.
Please be seated. I must say it's fun for me to see a clean-shaven photo of Harry. For those of you who knew him as clean-shaven, I actually knew him better in his last few years where we were competing to see whose beard was longer. I offer you now these readings from the Psalms. First, from Psalm 23. The King James Version. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. And yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely, surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. The second reading is from Psalm 121, the New Revised Standard Version. I lift up my eyes to the hills. From where will my help come? My help comes from the Lord, who made heaven and earth. He will not let your foot be moved, for he who keeps you will not slumber. He who keeps Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord is your keeper. The Lord is your shade at your right hand. The sun shall not strike you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord will keep you from all evil. He will keep your life. The Lord will keep your going out and your coming in from this time on and forevermore. May God bless these readings to our use and us to God's service in remembrance of Harry.
Oh. I always thought that God had a good sense of humor, but never so much as when I arrived at Springland Church and found out that Harry Adams, my professor of preaching, was in the congregation. He was always very discreet, even as a teacher and as a congregant. And this was his faith. From Paul's letter to the Romans. What then are we to say about these things? If God is for us, who is against us? He who did not withhold his own son, but gave him up for all of us, will he not with him also give us everything else? Who will bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is to condemn? It is Christ Jesus who died, yes, who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who indeed intercedes for us. Who will separate us from the love of Christ? Will hardship, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or peril, or sword? As it is written, for your sake we are being killed all day long, we are accounted as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. And from the Gospel of Luke in the 23rd chapter. Two others also who were criminals were led away to be put to death with him. When they came to the place that is called the Skull, they crucified Jesus there with the criminals, one on his right and one on his left. Then Jesus said, Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing. And they cast lots to divide his clothing. And the people stood by watching, but the leaders scoffed at him, saying, he saved others. Let him save himself if he is the Messiah of God, his chosen one. The soldiers also mocked him, coming up and offering him sour wine and saying, if you are the king of the Jews, save yourself. There was also an inscription over him, this is the King of the Jews. One of the criminals who were hanged there kept deriding him and saying, are you not the Messiah? Save yourself and us. But the other rebuked him, saying, do you not fear God, since you are under the same sentence of condemnation? And we indeed have been condemned justly, for we are getting what we deserve for our deeds. But this man has done nothing wrong. Then he said, Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. And he replied, truly, I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise. May God bless these readings to our hearts and us to God's service.
Paul, Susan, Lynn, family members, colleagues, friends, students, parishioners, how many relationships can there be to a group of people? How many generations can be captured in this room and imagining all the people that Harry has impacted through the generations? It is good to be here today. Harry's book on preaching was entitled Preaching, the Burden and the Joy. And I'm feeling both today. The burden I share with so many of you in grief, in losing the company and guidance of a trusted friend, a devoted parent, an invaluable administrator, a gifted preacher, a great chaplain, teacher, and Christian leader, and perhaps most of all, a genuinely kind man. The burden for me to speak is to try and capture any aspect, any facet of Harry's life, which was so big. The sheet of funeral instructions Harry left behind, and it was detailed. That sheet said, sermon, : David Bartlett or Ian Oliver. No burden there. But I know Harry would not have wanted just a retrospective eulogy. He would have wanted a Christian sermon on this day. The same simple message he preached in so many complex and enticing forms over the years, a message of confidence in God's grace through life, through death, through struggle, to life eternal. I want to thank all of you who've shared stories with me in the last 2 weeks, more than I can share here today or hope to capture, so I hope you will share them at the reception after the service and in the coming weeks and months as we remember Harry. We're just beginning to tap into that legacy. But as Harry said, the burden is matched with the joy. As he wrote in his preaching book, the demand to speak the word from the text to the congregation is a burden, but it is also a joy. When the word then becomes the word now, the people are nurtured in their faith, sustained in their hope, and strengthened in their love. To be an instrument of the transforming Spirit of God is to be blessed with profound joy. It was his willingness to be that instrument in which we rejoice today. A joy to remember that mentor, guide, leader, important work done, lives enriched, faith nurtured. In the same preaching book, the dedication, right after the title page, said, to Manette, who through the years has lightened the burden and enhanced the joy. And we cannot remember his life without also remembering hers and that strange and remarkable complementarity of such completely different personalities. Harry and I are strangely connected in just odd ways. He was the same age as my father, who was also an Army Air Corps officer from World War II. He was a YDS classmate of my first mentor, Robert Dewey. We both had ministries devoted to the sometimes neglected arts of Christian education, Christian nurture, administration, and preaching. And oddest of all, my research was on the mainline church of the 1970s. And one of the first books I read for my research was one of Harry's Christian ed books 30 years ago. I knew Harry for 12 years. Since I've been at Yale, and it all begins with an embarrassing story, embarrassing about me. In my first lunch with Harry, as I tried to find my feet at Yale and recognized in him a mentor, meeting with him as my predecessor in the pulpit at Battelle Chapel, I hoped for, yes, an explanation, but also perhaps a little dirt. I asked all kinds of questions about people and events, leaving, leading, openings. And Harry, as I would learn to expect over the years, pleasantly and artfully parried everyone. He wouldn't say a bad thing about anyone. And if there was ever a spiritual discipline I longed to emulate, it is that one. That title, The Burden and the Joy, seems to capture so much of Harry's story. It's a title of its time. And it's hard to imagine a book so honest titled that way today. And everything Harry did, it seemed there was an honesty about how important things like faith and community and relationship aren't easy. There was none of the self-promoting sort of faux enthusiasm of today's social media universe about Harry. Important things, he would say, take hard work, commitment, sometimes compromise, and a deep sense of higher values. Look at the scriptures he chose for today, and he did choose all of them. I think they carry a simple message. Confidence that we are kept and cared for by God, that goodness and mercy surround us in life and death, that we cannot be separated from the love of God in Christ Jesus by death, by powers, by our own sin, by doubt, a confidence that didn't need to shout its name, a confidence that didn't need to win people over, but just was. And you felt it when you were around him. In the last 2 weeks, I've read three of Harry's books, and I was struck by how they spoke to their time, the turbulent 70s and 80s, how they captured the deep struggles of those years, the dilemmas and doubts of the church, a sense of crisis and challenge, and yet how Harry, while taking the mood of the time seriously, always found a way to find in the midst of that confidence and faith. Though the mood was of lonely existentialist crisis, Harry always seemed to bring that crisis of decision around to a choice to commit to church, to family, to community, as worth the price, and perhaps as the source of that confidence itself. Everyone I spoke to about Harry talked about a quiet, unprepossessing, humble man that I knew. More than one person spoke of him as a calming presence in the storms of university crises or raising teenagers. There was strength that was never bullying, perspective when everyone else had lost theirs, patience that believed hard situations could be made better. He was easy to be around. He laughed often. He listened easily. He told good stories. But you always had the sense that an intense and serious mind was also churning somewhere behind those eyes. And as Lynn and Susan described to me yesterday, this quiet, calm person became a different person in the pulpit, with a louder voice and an assertive affect that you wouldn't expect. In our age, when informality was everything, Harry was a formalist, and the sermon was the form, an art form. Though no one quotes it anymore, for some good reasons, this made me think of Kipling's If, as I think of Harry. If you can keep your head when all around you are losing theirs and blaming it on you, if you can trust yourself when all doubt you, but make allowance for their doubting too, if you can wait and not be tired by waiting or be lied about, don't deal in lies, or being hated, don't give way to hating, and yet don't look too good or talk too wise. He had a surety, a confidence that God is faithful, that God is bigger than our problems, but also with us in our problems. And we see that confidence reflected in aspects of his life that only in retrospect can we really appreciate for their importance. Great administrators are rarely lauded. I don't know if you feel this way, but I think we really only notice good administration when it's missing. As Dean Sterling said, Harry was acting everything at Yale. Dean, director, chaplain, college head, professor, he had the remarkable ability to do almost any job. And when there was a crisis, as at Saybrook College in 1998, Harry would step in to the storm, listen to people, assess the situation, put out the fires, and then set that same unit on the road to its next step. And then he would step back and let others take the stage. It takes a unique strength, intellect, humility, and love of people to do that. He was also an institutionalist. He was a Yaley through and through in the best sense. I'm sure he questioned Yale many times, as he probably did the Christian church in America. But he believed that important things needed to be done, and he believed in doing them well and the right way. Caring for people, for him, I think, meant caring for the institutions that surrounded and supported and nurtured them. We live today in a time when faith in institutions has faltered, if not disappeared, for some good reasons. We see all too clearly the oppressive side of institutional life, the undemocratic processes, the foot-dragging and nostalgia for a mythical past. and at its worst, the hidden abuse and administrative denial. But Harry seemed to have a steady, grounded confidence that though institutions do falter, even fail, even abuse, that only institutions, only communities can do the things we most urgently need to educate those coming up, to transmit the gospel, to foster belonging and trust and community. Though so many think it will, social media will never replace these institutions, which, though certainly fallible, are also the only structures for solving problems and changing societies. Again, in his book On the Burden and Joy of Preaching, Harry wrote again about a strange kind of joy. He said it was joy in the weakness, joy in the ambiguities, joy in the demands, joy in the potential. As I read through his books, it was like he was writing his own eulogy. There was joy in serving others in community, even when it was hard, and the difficulty itself was a joy, as Jesus says. In his 1975 book, Priorities and People, probably read in more churches as an adult Sunday school book than any other theological book of that time. He addressed crises around race, the environment, liberation, protest movements, the Vietnam War, and poverty. He wrote in this little book that in response to crisis, what we need to do is set priorities, and that the first priority was people. He wrote, "We are concerned about making and keeping life human, about meeting the real needs of persons, about enabling people to reach their potential." He said, "Laws, mores, principles, and institutions are all important, but the gospel message is that people come first." In the last 2 weeks, I've heard so many stories of how Harry quietly mentored so many pastors, chaplains, faculty, colleagues, especially, it seems, women first breaking into the professions at that time that demonstrate his commitment to people first. One colleague wrote that Harry and Sam Sly, then 80, treated her, a young female lesbian colleague, with such respect as a trusted colleague and minister that she vowed always to treat her own younger colleagues with the same respect and dignity. To close, Harry wrote about four values in his Priorities and People book that seemed to capture so much of his life. First, loyalty. Fulfilling the obligations attendant upon our relationships, to be faithful to the promises we make to each other, defend the interests and guard the welfare of others across class, race, and age. He wrote that from loyalty comes the strength of relationships necessary to accomplish important work, and our loyalty to those around us flows from our ultimate loyalty to God. Second was sensitivity, which he said was humility, openness, and honesty. Third was persistence, in patience, in forgiveness, in suffering, which I think we saw so well in his time with Manette and then with Sam Sly. Finally, spirituality. Seeking God's purpose as Jesus did, living close to God, giving oneself in ministry to others, praying for others, and making our witness to the world. These are not lost virtues today, but remembering Harry and his thoughts remind us of priorities we may have forgotten in the heat of this moment. People come first. And relationships with people depend on working at the practices and virtues that sustain those relationships. Individual fulfillment may be our goal, but along the way, there are also obligations to serve, to listen, to mentor, that may mean stepping out of the spotlight so that others can shine. There's a deep consistency in Harry, rooted in faith. Corners can't be cut. No ends justify the means. I can't spend all my time complaining about Yale and yet expect it to change or grow. I can't give up in frustration with the church when it is only there that Christianity and all of its human reality can be lived out. In his book, What Jesus Asks, Harry concludes with these words about the Easter message. There is a sign for us, a strong and powerful conviction that the crucified Lord returned to his people, a conviction that the Lord has risen indeed. We live in a disturbing world and a troubling world. But Easter opens to us the mystery and wonder of this life and opens for us a new way into communion with the God who loves us. Today we celebrate a pastor in the best sense of the word, a pastor who was also a father and a husband, a loyal friend who made everything he touched better through his own deep confidence and hope, who lived out in real life in the real world of this complicated community of learning around us, and rooted ultimately in faith. Matthew 25 says, "Well done, thou good and faithful servant. Thou hast been faithful over a few things. I will make thee ruler over many things. Enter thou into the joy of thy Lord." Amen.
Get ourselves coordinated here. My sisters and I would like to briefly share some memories of our father. But before we do that, we want to extend our heartfelt thanks to all of you who are here today to share this day with us, which is obviously very sad for us, but also, as Ian said, full of joy. And we also want to extend our deep felt thanks to the Yale Divinity School, to Dean Sterling, into this tremendous, the Yale community, which has just been so supportive top to bottom. And the participants today from Spring Glen and from Whitney Center, we just can't thank you enough. So you've heard, you've already heard some themes about our Father, but obviously our experiences are also as a dad, but there's a lot of very common things about that. His quiet fortitude, is helping where needed, fixing things. He was a fixer in our house at all times. He was also a counterweight to the whirling dervish that was our mother. For those of you who knew our mother, she was something else, and in the best way. But he was just sort of a nice balance to that, and it always sort of kept our family from going off the rails. We have very strong memories of him at home, just very quiet, and often just reflecting. He would smoke his pipe at a time when people smoked pipes and men smoked pipes, and reading the Times in his wingback chair. The way he sort of approached things. Before I took on the chore as a teenager of mowing the lawn, he would mow the lawn, but he would do it in exactly the same pattern and exactly the same pace, just always the same and the most efficient manner possible of mowing the lawn. He had discovered that somehow, the most efficient way to do that. Every 5 years, he would paint our house. We'd get up on ladders and paint our house. And so that was just a little bit what he was. And growing up, he was our dad. And then as we got a little bit older, I learned a little bit more about what he was like in his other life, and learning a little bit about you know him all as at Yale. As Ian mentioned too, just sort of the transformation that happened with him when he got behind a pulpit and was preaching the thing that he was excelled at and loved so much. And I can also remember as a teenager sort of asking him, sort of his job and you're the associate dean and why aren't you the dean? Like, why aren't you the top guy? His response was always this, he loved what he did, and he loved to be able to fix things and to make things better, to make this community better, to make Yale better, to make our family better, that was really kind of who he was. So we miss him very much. It's very hard, but we are also comforted that his was a life well lived. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Susan. I also want to repeat what my brother said. Thank you so much for coming. I first want to say this place has a special significance for me since I was married here. It seems like yesterday, but it was actually 41 years ago. My uncle Buddy officiated, and my father walked me down the aisle, which was very important to me. I was nervous as we started down for our walk, but my father held my hand and squeezed it, and he said, it would be fine. And it was, sometimes, my husband said. And as my brother said, your kind comments have been wonderful. They all show how my father, with little fanfare, spent his life helping others. He was the same as a father, patient, kind, never losing his temper. As a kid, I was not terribly coordinated. No comments from my kids, please. And I could not learn to ride a bike. My father spent hours holding me up while I cried, don't let go. He never did. Teaching me to drive our stick shift Volkswagen Bug also must have tested his patience, but he never showed frustration, even after the second transmission replacement. He could, as my brother said, he could and did fix everything, including around the house. After my husband and I had our own house, we realized we couldn't fix anything. Papa, as my kids called him, would come to visit, and he would ask for the list. I listed every problem in the house, and he quiet and diligently checked off every item. There were many times we sat down to lunch and said, "Where's Papa?" He was at the hardware store, where he'd driven himself to pick up everything we needed. They knew him quite well at the hardware store. He was very helpful in the kitchen. In fact, he may have taken it a touch too far. When he was there for meals, everyone knew to hold on to your drinking glasses. If you left the table for even a few minutes, it would be gone when you got back. Papa would have picked it up and put it in the dishwasher. Even this past Christmas, despite our protestations, he insisted on moving furniture around the house. After dinner, he'd start moving the extra dining room chairs back into the living room. We drew the line at couches, however. And as many of you know, no one could have been more loving and patient when my mother suffered from her long illness. In his remarks on his 95th birthday party, he turned to us, to his family, and said he was proud of us for helping people. That was how he lived his life. My husband Kent and my children and their spouses, Zach and Evan, Katie and Aaron, and Sam and Zoe, will miss him. Our loss is great, but he will always be with us. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Lynn. Harry Baker Adams, my dad. The Reverend, the honorary doctor, the professor, the dean, the counselor, the philosopher, the scholar, the organizer, the leader, the problem solver, the son, the devoted husband, the father, the grandfather, the brother, the uncle, the voice of logic, and to one family member, a living hero. Now I'm tired. My dad got on a train from St. Louis to New Haven when he was 17 years old. He was beginning his freshman year at Yale, and it was sight unseen. Things were a bit different in 1942. With the exception of his service in the Air Force and a brief stint in the Midwest, he really never left. Yale became his new home, or became his home. It's where he met my mom, and so began their courtship and marriage of 67 years. We all know of his illustrious career at the university, not to mention the many hats that he wore over the years. At one point, the joke going around was that the president of Yale had Harry Adams on speed dial. He was always ready to jump in to fill any need or solve any problem. I am going to repeat something that I said at my mom's funeral, and this is an explanation of why the three of us choose to stand up here together. It is something that my sister, brother, and I have heard more than several times in reference to the fact that we genuinely seem to enjoy each other's company and most often get along. To quote, that would be, "Wow, your parents must have done something right." I would say a little more than something. Dad grew up in a musical family, his mother an accomplished concert pianist, and his sister played violin in the St. Louis Orchestra. A little known fact for many of you is that Dad played trombone in the Yale Marching Band. A little known fact to us, apparently Dad had a stand-up comedy routine about aging that he performed at the Whitney Center. Who knew? Those of you who knew my mom knew that she was a bit of a force, often one to be reckoned with. She did not withhold her thoughts or opinions. When Mom and I would lock horns, as loving mothers and daughters are bound to do, Dad was the calming force when I became overwrought, which was not infrequent. I truly believe that I would never have gotten through school without his guidance. He was able to explain things to me that teachers failed to communicate. He sat with me at the piano every night to practice. He taught me to ride a bike and to dive off the raft at Mixville Pond. One time out learning to drive with Mom was more than enough for both of us. Dad patiently taught me to drive, four on the floor, three on the wheel. Generally thought to have the patience of a saint, I was once asked if I had ever seen him get mad. My response, "Oh yeah, and I was responsible for both of those times." (Clears throat) How can you begin to thank someone for such ongoing and unconditional love? I'm not certain that we can even begin to try, but the best we can do is this. From the bottom of our hearts, we will always love you. Thank you, Dad.
Friends, will you join me in prayer? O God, before whom generations rise and pass away, we praise you for all your servants who, having lived this life in faith, now live eternally with you. Especially we thank you for your servant, Harry Baker Adams, whose baptism is now complete in death. We praise you for the gift of his life, for all in him that was good and kind and faithful, for placing your word upon his heart and on his lips, for guiding his steps all his days, for the grace you gave him that enabled him to serve you faithfully. We thank you that for Harry, death is past, and that he has now entered the joy you have prepared. He was nourished at your table on earth. Welcome him at your table in the heavenly kingdom, where he rests now with his beloved Manette and the company of all your faithful servants. Comfort Harry's family, his children, Susan and Lynn, and Paul, their spouses, his grandchildren, and all who were blessed to be a part of his family. Be with them, we pray. And be with the Whitney Center community, the Spring Glen congregation, and with all who loved Harry as they remember his life, his love, his passion, his devotion. We thank you for his long service to the Yale community, for the many ways he transformed students' lives, providing counsel and wisdom, encouraging their curiosity, serving as a light to their paths. We are grateful that in so many ways and in so many places, his pastoral care extended to the strong and the hurting alike. Surround us this day and in the days and months to come, and provide consolation to all who will miss Harry's gentle presence. Let his spirit live on in our actions of compassion and love, reminding us of the faith that sustained Harry his whole life long. O God of grace, you have given us new and living hope in Jesus Christ. Carve on our hearts your good news, that neither death nor life, nor things present nor things to come, shall ever be able to separate us from your love. Let our faith be our consolation, and eternal life our hope. O God, support us all the day long, until the shadows lengthen and the evening comes, and the busy world is hushed, and the fever of life is over, and our work is done. Then, in your mercy, grant us a safe lodging and a holy rest and peace at the last. Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant Harry. Acknowledge, we humbly pray, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive him into the arms of your mercy, into the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of the saints. Amen. Amen.
Before I close with the benediction, one that is very much Harry's, it is the prayer he delivered at his beloved Manette's memorial service as per her wishes. Allow me a brief note of gratitude for how he blessed my life from the moment I first arrived at Yale, truly a stranger in a strange land. Harry was the steady hand I didn't expect to receive. It was the hand he simply offered so graciously and freely right from the start. I did have him on speed dial. He was my Yale decoder ring, gentle friend, and cheerleader. In every commencement except for the last, he waited for me on the platform to give me that good luck hug and say it'll be fine. And I will always be grateful for him. He was the very embodiment of Christian nurture. Friends, hear now this benediction. O Lord, support us all the day long until the shadows lengthen and the evening comes and the busy world is hushed and the fever of life is over and our work is done. Then in your mercy, grant us a safe lodging and a holy rest and peace at the last. Amen. Please join us for a reception in the old common room, and I just ask that you wait for the family to process out before you leave. Thank you.